Good morning, everyone. We'll continue our discussion on gingival surgical techniques. We discussed the first part, that is gingival curettage, and the second part we'll discuss about gingivectomy. Now, what do you understand by the term gingivectomy? Now, it simply means excision of the gingiva. And while doing excision of the gingiva, when you are reshaping the gingiva, then you are providing accessibility and visibility for completely removing the deposits that are present on the tooth surface. So that is what gingivectomy hopes to do. Now, basically, in which all cases we do gingivectomy? We do mainly in case of gingival enlargements. Now, you may find, we've already discussed about the different types of gingival enlargements. It can be inflammatory, can be drug induced, it can be condition, it can be due to systemic diseases, or it can be neoplastic, or it can be false enlargement. Whatever it is, when you have an enlargement, once you remove all the inflammation and if the enlargement is still persisting, probably you can do this procedure called as gingivectomy. Right? So indication one is elimination of gingival enlargements. That is a primary aim of doing gingivectomy. Now, another thing is elimination of suprabony pocket, regardless of the depth if the pocket pod is fibrous and firm. Now, if you have a suprabony pedonal pocket in the upper anterior aspect, and then if you are trying to remove by gingivectomy, what is going to happen is you are removing the whole of the gingiva and you are subjecting the patient to an anesthetic appearance. So that is not something that you usually do. That this was done, all these indicators is an indication, but you know, this is not an indication that we currently do. Now we do it mainly for elimination of gingival enlargement. If you have a supraboni pocket or if you have a supraboni periodontal abscess. Now you don't do gingivectomy nowadays, even though this is considered as an indication, because of a lot of gingiva that is being lost, that is a postoperative recession that is going to occur there, and because of the anesthetic effects. Basically, you are doing gingivectomy fully for elimination. But when asked in your question paper, probably you will have to write all these indications. What are the contraindications? Now, if you want to do any alteration to the bone, now if you have to do an osteoplasty, or if you have to regenerate bone, like putting some bone grafts or some membrane. Now, in all these cases, you never do this gingivectomy. In all those cases, what you do is you reflect the flap so that you can see the underlying bone. When you do a gingivectomy, you can't see that the bone is not being, you can't see the bone. Okay. Now, if the bottom of the pocket is apical to the mucogingival junction, you never try to eliminate that pocket by doing a gingivectomy. The reason is what I discussed before. Now, if you have a pocket deep to the mucogingival junction and try to eliminate the hole, especially in the case of upper or lower anteriors, to remove by the pocket by means of gingivectomy, the whole of that gingiva is going to occur. A lot of recession that is going to occur. And aesthetic considerations. Don't do aggressive type of gingivectomy, especially pocket elimination procedures. Now, what are the different methods by which you can do gingivectomy? Now, you have gingivectomy knives and scalpels. So that is a routinely done, the common method, and it is the most recommended method also. Then you can do by means of electrosurgery, electrocautery can be used. You all know that nowadays you have soft tissue lasers, and this has made our job simpler in terms that you have certain advantages, but always doing gingivectomy by means of a laser is a time consuming. And then again, from an academic point of view, you can use a lot of chemicals also for reshaping or for removing this gingival tissue. So we'll discuss first about the surgical gingivectomy. In surgical gingivectomy, what you should do is you should explore these pockets. You know, the gingiva will be enlarged. you should know where to put an incision in such a way that you can remove the enlarged tissue. So basically, you can have an instrument which is known as a pocket marker. Now, the pocket marker is an instrument which looks like your tweezer. Now, you can see a Now, this is a pocket marker. This is a pocket marker. So, it's like a tweezer. Now, one end of your tweezer goes to the bottom of the sulcus. And on the other end, what you can see is you have a pointed aspect, which is almost perpendicular like this pointed aspect. So, what you do is insert like this and just press like that. So, when you press, what happens is this part, this pointed aspect will create a bleeding point in relation to the outer aspect of the gingiva. So you now this bleeding point is in accordance with the bottom of the gingival sulcus. That is what basically we are going to look at. Now when you look at here, what you do again? So what you do is you create multiple bleeding points. So the pockets are marked in relation to a tooth at multiple areas. Okay, you can start from the most distal aspect and come to the midline. Then you can go to the lingual aspect. So, by which using a pocket marker, you are probing, marking all the pockets. So that is the first step. Now, after that, you can do is you can using it, you usually use a gingivectomy knife. You have different types of gingivectomy knife, which we'll be discussing, or by means of a BP plate and handle, you put incisions. Now, when you put incisions, it can be a continuous type of incision. So, you start from the most distal aspect and you put an incision like this and you continue like this and you continue. When you put this incision, the handle should be angulated in such a way that after removing the tissues, it should be almost like original tissue. So almost at 45 degrees to the long axis, so that slice tissue architecture is being created because the interdental areas is more deep. So what you do is you give more prominence to the root and the dental area is more depression. Like what you do with festooning in relation to a complete denture. So you do this festooning so that you keep root coming. Similarly, you have to incorporate all these when you keep an incision here. So this continuous incision is going to be quite difficult when you do it for the first time. So what you can do is you can do a discontinuous incision. You start with the and insert it like this and you go like this and in here. Okay. From this aspect, again, you go like this and in here. When you go like this and so and then you remove this as one piece, remove this as one piece, remove this as one piece. It'll be like so. The result will be the same in both. Maybe continuous or it may be discontinuous incision. So what are the instruments that we use? We use periodontal knives. You have two types of periodontal knives. One is a Kirkland knife and the other is a Auburn's knife. Kirkland knife is a kidney-shaped knife. Okay. Auburn's knife is a spear-shaped knife which is used in the interdental areas. And you can use BP blade. Number 11, 12, 15, 15C. And you can also use water instruments like micromotor burrs and all for also doing gingivectomy. Now, this is the typical what is the instrument known as the Kirkland knife. This is the Auburn's knife. Here you have different types of BP blades over here. And you can see this blade is the number 11 blade. This is the 12 blade. This is 12D. You can see that it's sharp here as well as in the outermost aspect. That's a 12D blade. This is the 15, number 15 blade. And when it is angulated like this, it's called as a 15C blade. So all these types of blades can be used for doing gingivectomy. Now, what is the angle in which you put an incision? Now, you create a bleeding point like this. excision is started at apical to the points marking the course of the pocket, directed coronally to a point between the base of the pocket and the crest of the bone. So from the base of the pocket and here the crest of the bone. So you go more apical to here, and between the bone and this point, you give a 45 degree rotation. Incision should be as close to the bone. It should be as close to the bone, but not exposable. Bevel at 45 degrees, and you should recreate the festooning that is present in a normal incision. Right? As I told you before, you can either put a continuous, the discontinuous incision like this, or you can put a continuous incision like this. Then after that, after you put all the incisions, you remove the excised pocket wall, clean that area well. Now, a lot of, after you remove the, these tissues, you know, you may find a lot of deposits within this roof surface. Remove all that, scale that area well, and then pack that area. That is a basic procedure of doing a gingivectomy. Now, this is a diagrammatic representation. These are the pockets are being marked. Or you can use a PP plate like this. You are putting incision from the apical aspect, directed coronally, interdental areas. You can do a interdental open knife can be used. And then this instrument is being, curettes are being used, and the tissue is being lifted up, and then large tissues. All these areas, what you can do is you can clean that area, irrigate that area, clean that area, do a scaling, then pack that area. So this is a basic procedure for doing a gingivectomy. Now this is a picture that is present in your textbook actually. Now this you can see this is a drug-induced gingival, such massive enlargement. So when the enlargement becomes very large, like sometimes the enlargement is so huge that it can cover most of the tooth also. Such areas, it's very difficult to stay where to start your incision itself is quite difficult. Sometimes you have to do multiple procedures also if the enlargement is so severe like that. So basically, this is your open, this is your focal and knife. You angle it in 45 degrees to the long end for the tooth. Put incisions, and then in the internal areas, you can remove by means of the open knife. And all these overhangings or tissue tags that are being removed by means of this tissue nippers can be used. And also you can use slow speed burrs can be used so that you know a correct architecture of that festooning of the thing can get you. And this is almost the final result. This is the pack is being given. And look how well it has been. This is the pre-operative, and from this they have taken it here. All the normal anatomy, the normal contours, knife edge contour, everything has been restored. Another case, this gingiva is enlarged. The patient had a small frenum along with that. This was also going for orthodontic treatment. So they wanted to place the brackets in the correct position. So pockets were marked and the gingiva was done. And this is the lower teeth. Exactly. Pockets were marked. The brackets are here. Can you imagine placing brackets properly here? So in that case, we put it here. Another case with massive enlargement. Again, this is a case in the textbook. In these cases, again, this was done by a procedure by Jonas, internal bevel gingivectomy. Here, we discussed about internal bevel incisions during the in-app procedure, that is excision in the apical procedure. That is, you give an incision from the coronal aspect more apically and about 15 degrees angulation. And this is how you remove the tissue. After that, internal bevel incisions are given, you remove the tissue, then surgery. And you can see that it's gone from here to here. But here, you know, when the enlargement is so severe, see, even there is some amount of enlargement persisting here. This is the one problem associated. You have to do a gingivectomy or again a gingivectomy or some amount of gingivoplasty to make it more aesthetic. patient is satisfied. Now you have to come, you have to know that it is not a gingivoplasty. Now, gingivoplasty is similar to gingivectomy, but the purpose is different. Gingivectomy is done to remove pockets, and reshaping is just part of the technique. So, whenever there is pocket, that is especially the pseudo type of pockets, you do a gingivectomy, and you reshape, that is part of the technique. But when you don't have any pockets, that is, there is no pseudo pocket, there is no large enlargements. But the gingiva is anesthetics, aesthetic, some the zenith, the contours of the gingiva may be not correct. So you do a little bit of gingivectomy to correct that for only for aesthetic purpose. Such procedure is known as gingivoplasty. So it is defined as the recontouring of the gingiva to achieve physiological contours in the absence of pockets. So the gingivectomy is done in the presence of pseudo pockets. Gingivoplasty is done just for reshaping in the absence of pockets. So that is something that you have to know. Now look, this is the zenith is here. When you compare this, you know, the zenith should be somewhere here. Right? It looks totally unnecessary, but what they've done is, from this situation, just by doing a gingivectomy, there's no aesthetic. Now, next is healing after surgical gingivectomy. Now, what does it? Now, whenever the question on gingivectomy is being asked, definitely you have to write about healing after gingivectomy also. So, what is initially, you know, this, when you do a gingivectomy, it is usually an open wound. And healing occurs by means, not by means of primary intention. Healing occurs in a surgical gingivectomy by means of secondary intention. Okay? So initially there is formation of a surface clot, and the tissue that is beneath the clot is acutely inflamed. And by about 24 hours, you may find connective tissue cells, mainly the blood vessel cells, that is angioplasty, may be seen. By the third day, you may find a lot of fibroblasts coming into action. And you have a highly vascular granulation tissue that is being formed, which actually grows coronally to form the free gingival margin in the surface. Look, when you do a surgical gingivectomy like this, look here. Here, there was a sulcus. Everything is gone when you do excise the gingiva. Now, the sulcus has to form here during. What happens is that the highly vascular connective tissue grows coronally, forming the free gingival margin and the sulcus. After 12 to 24 hours, the epithelial cells from the margins migrate over the granulation tissue, separating it from the contaminated surface cloth. So, epithelial healing takes place. Obviously, you have all around the wound, you have epithelium. So, this epithelium will migrate. So, this will migrate between the clot that is being formed and the granulation tissue, and separates the clot. Right? After 5 to 14 days, by the second week, you may find complete surface epithelialization is complete. But complete connective tissue healing after the surgical injection will take place for almost 2 months, 7 weeks. Right? So these are the steps of healing after surgical injection. Now we were discussing about how to do a gingivectomy using a scalpel. Now, the second method of doing gingivectomy is gingivectomy by means of electrosurgery. Now, what does it? What are the advantages of doing gingivectomy by means of electrosurgery? One is it permits adequate tissue contouring, and there is less. The problem with gingivectomy is, you know, whenever you are excising the gingiva using a scalpel, there is going to be a lot of bleeding there. So that is going to impede your surgical site. But when you're using a laser or for that matter an electrosurgery, what the advantage is there is no bleeding. So you can add, you know, with these tips, you can actually contour the tissue very well. Now, when you do a surgical gingivectomy, the initial incision should be very, very precise so that you should get adequate contouring. But here, you know, just by you can carve the tissues and you can bring it to the desired shape. But the disadvantage is in patients with overly sheathed pacemakers, this electrocautery can can interfere with the functioning of pacemakers. So it's not much advice. Is, you know, it burns flesh. When you cauterize it, there's burning of flesh, and that is really not, it creates an unpleasant odor, actually. And if bone is being touched, it can result in irreparable damage of the bone. And if you're touching the cementum, it can cause cemental burn. These are some of the disadvantages of doing electrocautery. So it is usually limited to superficial procedures, especially in periodontics. These are the four different procedures in which you do electrosurgery. As I said, removal of gingival enlargements can be, gingivectomy can be done, gingivoplasty can be done, frenectomy and the relocation of muscle attachments can be done, and incision for periodontal abscess and pericardial flap. Pericardial flap can be easily removed. These are the different procedures in periodontics using electrosurgery. Now we have a lot of hype about this laser. Laser is a very modern tool. You can't say that modern. It's been used for about more than 5 to 10 years now. You can have different types of lasers. Lasers are classified as hard tissue lasers and soft tissue lasers. Tissue lasers are the lasers used on the tooth as well as bone. And if it's a hard tissue laser, it won't have no effect on the soft tissue. Likewise, you have soft tissue lasers where you can do soft tissue surgery, but it is not going to have any action on hard tissues. So the wavelength of use and the wavelength of use lasers used in dentistry ranges from 10,600 nanometer to 1,064 nanometer. Only thing is, you know, you have to use this, you have to understand the functioning or the functions of a laser, and you have to use it cautiously. It's a wonderful tool. But the only problem nowadays is, you know, the cost of this, the equipment is very high, and that makes this not accessible for every dentist. That is the only problem. But once, I think, probably in a few years, you know, the cost of laser is going to come down. And a tool that probably we are going to use like a rotomantis. Then last is you can do gingivectomy by means of chemicals. Similarly, I explained in the last class that you can do gingivectomy curettage by means of chemicals. You apply chemicals to that area. But you know, you can't reshape the gingiva. You can't predict the extent of depth penetration of this chemical into the gingiva, and it creates a lot of sloughing and other disadvantages. So it is not being followed nowadays. It's just a historical perspective. And we used to use 5% paraformaldehyde and potassium hydroxide for doing chemosurgery by gingivectomy by chemosurgery. Disadvantages: depth of action. You can't control the depth of action, depth of penetration. Gingival remodeling, this festooning and all, cannot be by means of chemicals. And epithelialization, formation of reformation of junctional epithelium and attachment of alveolar crust fibers. So the healing after this type of gingivectomy by means of chemicals is very slow. So these are the different methods by which you can do gingivectomy. it is nothing but excision of the gingiva. You can do by means of scalpels or by means of knives. You can do by means of electrosurgery, you can do by means of lasers, and you can actually do by means of chemicals, which you cannot do now. So I think that's the end of this